And we're on.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
I'm Seth Rudetsky.
And this is, oh.
This is.
I am your husband, James Wesley.
It's our 20th show.
It's actually, is it our 20th? It's our 20th right now. Yeah, okay, well, there you go. Welcome to Stars in the House.
Hey, guys.
A benefit web series for the Actors Fund.
Yeah, and it's so funny because I feel like, oh, my God, I'm saying the same boring thing all the time. We keep finding out from people, they don't really know what the Actors Fund is. It's not just for actors. It's for, as Bibi Newark said last night, in the old days, anyone that worked in show business was an actor. You could be a curtain puller, makeup person. You were an actor. Yeah. So it's
I had no idea. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know why it was called the Actors Fund. Now I know.
Right.
So it's for anybody in show business, actor, dancer, singer, wedding singer, box office person, anyone can turn to help with the Actors
Fund. Anyone who's a professional performing artist, especially at this time in our country, world's history, if you need help, go to the Actors Fund. There's, you can go actorsfund.org at the top. But actually, Seth, can you put the banner up for, and you can apply for assistance.
The Actors Fund banner? I don't think I actually have that.
Okay, that's all right. You can go to StarsInTheHouse and actorsfund.org.
You could just go to us and it'll have the information, but actorsfund.org or StarsInTheHouse.com. And by the way, when you donate to StarsInTheHouse.com, it all goes to the Actors Fund, which needs more money than ever because nobody is working.
Right.
And they have less money than ever because all their fundraisers have been basically canceled. They do the Red Bucket Brigade. They get money from Broadway Cares when they collect money in the Red Buckets. That's over.
Right.
They're a giant fundraiser that was going to honor Matthew Broderick and Sarah Jessica Parker. Canceled. So all the normal ways they make money, they ain't making it. And yet all these people need money. And that's why through these $5, $10, $50 donations, we've raised since Monday night, are we allowed to say?
We are, but before we get to that, because here's some that came in at the end of the matinee with Billy Porter. So we like to give some shout outs to those of you who are tuning in for the first time. Janet from Missouri gave $25. Dennis from California, $40. Laura from South Carolina, $50. Bruce from New York, $25. Connie from Pennsylvania, $35. Trish from Arizona.
We haven't heard from you guys.
$50. Kristin and Debbie from Ohio, $50. Thank you so much for giving to the Actors Fund. And since last Monday, we have raised, with your help, for the Actors Fund, over $100,000.
I mean, this is just from those donations.
Right.
Like, it's not like we're getting corporate sponsorship or anything. It's just people, it's so generous, especially in a time where there's such economic uncertainty. It really is amazing. And speaking of generous, every single star that's, I mean, no one's making any money. So every star has been giving their time. They've been singing up a storm. I mean, the theater community, the acting community, TV community is all very generous.
Well, and not only giving their time, literally
giving their stuff,
which, you know, those of you who maybe didn't see, Seth, bring up the picture.
We had Sondheim specials. So we had
on
Joanna,
Sunday.
Joanna Gleason and Chip Zine, the baker and his wife. There was a baker and his wife, and she was, anyway, Joanna was like, hey, look what I have. You don't know that song?
Sweetie, no, I don't.
Well, Sweetie Todd was doing, there was a barber and his, anywho.
Okay.
So Joanna was like, hey, Bernadette Peters had a staff and Into the Woods, greens, nothing but greens. This is the staff. And Joanna Gleason held it up and she said, you know what? I think it's time to auction this for the Actors Fund. She's auctioning it for the Actors Fund. And then suddenly every star is like, wait, I stole a prop from my show.
And so, okay. So you know what I just realized? Mm-hmm. What is one of the wonderful things about doing this is, you know, we've got our volunteer staff that we're expanding in order to be able to do this and keep our commitment to doing a matinee and evening show literally every single day until Broadway reopens.
Broadway.
But because things are so last minute in making this happen, it was only Sunday morning that I emailed Joanna Gleason and I thought, oh, could she do our Sondheim show? That's in 5 hours.
Oh, yeah, we booked it last minute. Billy Porter was booked last night at 8 o'clock.
Right.
So, yeah, so Joanna was like, sure.
And Joanna was like, sure. And she was like, have you talked to Chip yet? And like, no, we haven't gotten to him yet. And Chip said yes. But my point is, because Joanna was so willing to just right away email and say, and then call us and say, okay, what do you want me to do? That then led to her going into her class. We hadn't even thought about that. Just in the next couple hours after I spoke to her, but before the show, and got the staff.
And now we have so much stuff.
Yeah.
Laura Benanti is giving her Shoots and the Sound of Music. Tina Fey is giving her old headshot from Chicago. I'm gonna post all this stuff soon. It's so hilarious. But you can go to starsinthehouse.com.
Yeah, and there's an auction icon there, I don't know, hyperlink. I know that Laura Benanti's Shoes from Sound of Music are up. The staff from Into the Woods.
And also, Betty Buckley is donating set pieces from Cats.
Yeah.
Literally the heavy side layer that lifted her up. She has plus her crazy week, which hasn't been washed since 1982. Just go to Stars.
They're not all up yet, but they're getting there. So so be patient with us. And it actually gave us an idea because a lot of people have been emailing.
Yes, this is a great idea.
Fans from all over who have memorabilia that was from, like, I don't know, the original, I don't know, name of the show, Sweeney Todd or whatever.
Someone has, like,
right?
Billy Elliot autographed shoes.
Right. And we said, in order, because the Actors Fund, they're all working so hard, instead of inundating them, how about donating it to a local performing arts organization and do an eBay auction for them? Because we're all in this together.
Yeah.
And so help your people in your local area. So
yes, yeah,
so
if you have something to donate, and by the way,
we encourage you to do that.
People keep writing to us saying now they want to do benefits for their own theater companies. You're like, what are you guys using? We discovered this. James discovered it
Sunday morning.
Yeah.
Right before the call with Joanna Gleason. Like, how in the hell are we going to? Oh, actually, yeah.
That was the week last before.
I'm getting them all confused.
It's StreamYard.
It's
super easy.
And people are writing to us saying that they're going to do the same thing in their local communities. It's so cool.
Yeah, it's such a great idea. And it's so easy to use. We're so technically not savvy.
Believe
we can
me.
Do it.
Had no idea.
Are we going to bring in our stars?
I think so, Seth. Let's go.
Okay, this is very exciting. We have Broadway power couple. Super power couple. They're both brilliant. Both stars of... That's wicked. That wasn't a mistake. It was written that way. Okay, also, Sebastian, also. Lady Saber, you're. Anyway, why am I performing? The point is, they're both brilliant. Please welcome Stephanie J. Block and Sebastian Arcelus.
Hello. Hi, guys.
Beautiful compared to the sound check, I gotta be honest. What happened?
I actually took a bath with Vivi if you wanna get really into it. Come on. Killing two birds with one stone.
And the makeup looks stunning. Sebastian, I love the hair. Is that your social distancing hair? I haven't had time to shave.
It's the same always. It's a bird's nest. But yes, it's good,
guys,
to see you guys. Thanks for having us.
First of all, we heard the total. What in the what?
Right?
Congratulations. Incredible. That is incredible. I have something. So when he sings one of his solos, I'll run upstairs. I'll grab it and bring it on down.
Okay. Vivi? Wait, it's not Vivi, is it? Because you can't.
Not auctioning.
That's not legal.
So we had a good day with Vivi. We'll keep her till tomorrow, and then we'll keep you updated.
Okay.
P.S. Tell everybody your quote about your fun, wild child.
Oh, I always tell people that we have three children, and her name is Vivi.
It's a great line reading.
She is just so full of life, but it doesn't stop, guys. She wakes up at about 6 o'clock in the morning, which is a blessing because it used to be 4:50 in the morning for about 2.5 years. All our parent friends kept saying, oh, it's just a phase. It'll pass. It didn't pass. So at least now we're like at 6:20. And then, you know, we put her to bed about 7:30. And, but it's a full day. And having her here in the house, you know, it's a real balance. It's a real juggle.
She's gotten so used to having us that tonight she was like crying because she didn't want to let us go. And I was like, we're in the basement.
Your playroom.
We're not leaving the house.
Sweet.
Hey, one of the questions I ask everyone is, what are you guys doing to stay healthy during this? Spiritually, emotionally, physically?
That also, I think, goes back to having a kid, right? Because most of our day is focused on her. And we know that, like, outside of this bubble, a whole lot of horrible things are happening and friends are passing away. And we have to keep that quiet. I think Vivi picks up on our fears and on our anxieties. And so for those 14 hours, it's about creating family memories. It's about imaginative play. It's about baking and crafts. And then Seb's eyes will get big, like, can I talk to you? And then I'll go off to the room and for 30 seconds, we'll touch base and you'll have to kind of suppress it and go back to Vivi. Yeah. And then after we put her to bed is really when we kind of, you know, touch base again on the day and debrief on how we're feeling. And we're very honest. If I have to cry, I go upstairs and I take a good 20, 30 minutes to myself. But it's really a bizarre thing because we want her to feel. So far, we have been stuck in this house for 2 weeks. We started two Thursdays ago.
Right.
So for her, we just want it to be like really great memories, that long spring break where we were together and it was quiet time. But I don't know if I'm healthy. I'll be real honest. I mean, it's really a strange juxtaposition to hear the news, to know what the reality of the matter is, and then to be mama and daddy and to keep her in this safe bubble of play and love and hope. And it's really a facade.
You know what? I don't think it's any different for us with Julie, who's 19. I was telling Seth when we began 2 weeks ago of being here at our house outside the city, I told Seth I'm really thankful that she's here, because you have to, as a parent, set an example. It doesn't matter the age. And so me, it keeps me grounded.
Yeah.
You know, even if I'm feeling a certain way, and I know she's watching, but it's like she knows us. But you still have to look for, as Dr. LaPook quotes his mom, the silver lining. And like, we're together, and you have to, otherwise it becomes too overwhelming.
That's right. And she saw a picture of the virus on TV. And I made the mistake. I just said, it's a flower. And it's a flower that we're not quite sure what it does, but it gets in people's systems and it's making them sick. So we just have to stay away from the flower and let the doctors and the scientists figure that out. And she'll come to me with questions about our garden, or, you know, I'll cough and she'll be like, is that the flower? I'll be like, no, that's not the flower. So I don't know what sort of fib I've dug myself, but in the moment when she saw that image of the virus and it looked like a flower, we're just going with that narrative.
Yeah, you know, I can't stop thinking about Vivi waking up. Let me just say, how old is she now?
Five. She just turned five, yeah.
Okay, once she starts school, the fun part with Julie, what you're gonna experience is every day having to go to school, refusing to wake up, cannot wake up. However, on the weekends, when you finally do get to sleep, 7 a.m. shaking you. Yep, for Hannah Montana. So get ready for that, Joy.
Hey, you guys might like, I know you'll love this. Look at this.
We're watching around the world.
Hi, Seth, James, Steph, and Seb. I'm watching from Adelaide, Australia. Thank you for sharing. She's getting me through.
Is it like the next day in Australia? Like, right? What next is it morning, in Australia?
Right? It is. It's like 8 or 9, 8, 15.
Good morning.
Wow, Michael. Hello.
Thank you for tuning in.
Speaking of the next day, Leah Salonga emailed us. Oh, she's going to do the show Saturday. And she said, can I do it? And we're like, yeah, you can do it. And I said, what time do you want? She said, well, I'm in Manila. There's a time difference. So she chose to do 2 p.m. because then it's only 2 a.m. in Manila. We're going to stay up. And by the way, whenever I think of Adam, I think of...
Yeah.
Have either one of you ever done a concert at 2 a.m.? Have you ever done a concert that late before?
No, but I've done a rehearsal. The Muni does their dress rehearsals, right? Overnight. Speaking of Betty Buckley's wig, I did Cats at the Muni, and they called me the donkey ghost because my wig was just like this crazy thing, and my ears were massively huge. And they decided to click all these production shots at like 4 o'clock in the morning where, you know, you try to learn your cat makeup. I looked effing crazy.
Talk about why they have the rehearsals at night, because that's so crazy, so interesting.
Because everything's in rep, right? So as soon there is no, we dovetail performances. So one show will close on a Sunday and the next one opens on a Monday. And the only time you can rehearse is in the middle of the night. Same with the Disneyland parades. So we would be called in at like midnight to be ready to do the Disneyland parades or the Disneyland shows in the middle of the night, so you could open that next situation the very next day.
Theater people have so much stamina. All right, so Sebastian, hold up right now. You're in your
basement.
You hear us?
Playroom.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, you used to live when we were on like 115, right?
Oh, we were in Harlem. Yeah.
Right. That was a long time ago. 10 years ago or so.
Yeah, we left about 7 years ago. Yeah.
And we left like 10. All right, well, speaking of where we used to live, sing your first song, Sebastian, if you would.
Me first?
Yes.
Oh, goodness.
I'm going to go get the auction item.
Perfect. Okay. Bye, Stephanie.
Bye.
You know, the part of the...
I love you.
There we go. Part of the, talking about staying healthy mentally is that anytime we sort of start to get overwhelmed, we stop and we think about everybody that's in New York. We're in Jersey. And all of our friends and all the essential workers and healthcare workers that are just working their tails off for us, for everyone. And it shuts us up right quick in terms of how we're, I mean, you know, we have to sort of come to terms with how we're feeling, but also send as much of that energy out to them. And I'm sure you guys have been covering this over the last 20 performances, but we're all in this together, which is why I chose this particular song. And let me know if the sound is off, but give me one second here.
And everyone needs to focus on Sebastian's placement on the A because he actually able to vibrato it. It's so light. I love it.
Oh, God. Don't set it up so crazy. Okay, here we go.
Hurry.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Have a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. Me, I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. 'Cause I'm in a New York state of mind. I've seen all the movie stars in their fancy cars and their limousines. I've been high on the Rockies under the evergreens.
Yes.
Yeah, I know what I'm needing. I don't want to waste more time. I'm in a New York state of mind. It was so easy living day by day, out of touch with rhythm and blues. But now I need a little give and take. The New York Times, the Daily News. Oh, it comes down to reality, and that's fine with me, 'cause I let it slide. I don't care if it's Chinatown or on Riverside. I don't have any reasons, I've left them all behind. I'm in a New York state of mind. Hear me, I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. 'Cause I'm in a New York state of mind.
Ooh. That was amazing. These comments here.
I love that one on top. That one.
What's right here?
Yeah.
We're supposed to be seeing a Broadway show tonight, so I appreciate this so much. Isn't that nice?
Katie.
And look at this. You're bringing so much joy to us here in the UK.
This is live, people.
And this right here, really, talk about people on the front lines. Thank you so much. I'm only home when I'm off, and this makes me happy. I'm a jail deputy, and they just won't show us.
Wow. Ziggy, you're amazing. Stay safe.
Yeah.
Can we talk about what time it is in the UK, though?
I think it's 5 hours ahead. No, so it's 1 in the morning, 1:20.
Well, oh, actually, she's saying it there.
Hold on. Let's see.
What a treat before bedtime.
Aww.
In the UK, great voice at 8 p.m. tonight. We all stood for our NHS. Oh, I heard about that. They all stood up for the NHL to honor them. They did a
NHS.
Yeah, they did a countrywide honoring of them. Wow. They all stood for them.
Wow.
That's so great. I want everyone to just hear the story from the, I've never heard you both tell it together.
Okay. About
Sebastian basically psychically knowing what he wanted, going for it, Stephanie resisting. Yeah, Sebastian having that, I know, but still, she said, no, you were like Gene Dixon. I want to hear anybody say anything.
Yeah. Some people think it's sweet. Some people think it's creepy. I just was persistent.
It's like 2% creepy, 98% amazing. So you were both doing, which is The Wizard and I. You're both doing Wicked on the Road. And what? Sebastian, you were like, yes.
That's how I was. That was like it. I was floored by her. It was pretty immediate. I have to admit that it threw me for a loop. I mean, in all those ways that you sort of read about Cheesley, I mean, I couldn't sleep at night. I couldn't eat. I was journaling. I never journaled a day in my life. I mean, I wrote a book while I was in locked up in this hotel room while on tour because I just couldn't grapple with this woman.
Every chapter of the book is like, I'm in Seattle. I'm in love with you. I'm in Cincinnati and I'm in love with you. I'm in Detroit and I'm in love with you. And then when we got married, no. And he gave me the book for my birthday a year from when, you know, we were first introduced. And then when we were getting married, he said at the end of his vows, and we're in Italy and I'm in love with you. And I just wept. Yeah. No. So through that, it was the end of my tour, right? Yeah. So I had already been on tour for like 10 months and I was pooped and I was elfing as much as I could. And then when I knew we were going to get a new Fiero, I didn't handle it with a whole lot of grace. I was like, are you kidding me? I have to rehearse with this person. I have chemistry with this person.
I had to beg to sing As Long As You're Mine like 10 minutes before the pudding.
I was like, you got to practice tape, don't you? Why don't you just practice at home? I'll see you at the pudding. I was not a good person. And yet he still wanted to marry me. So I left the tour. I came home back to New York. I went through a little bit of therapy because I had broken up with my boyfriend of 10 and a half years at the end of the tour. And then he would call and be like, hey, I'm coming into town on Monday. Do you want to have dinner? Or, hey, I have a dentist appointment on Monday. Do you want to ha ha ha?
Just making things up.
And one day I was...
You have no teeth. I'm actually going.
There was a store called Roslyn. There was a jewelry store on 74th and Columbus. And I went in there and I was like, I'm buying myself that ring. I deserve it. I've worked hard on the Wicked Tour. Yeah. But then when I put it on my finger, it was a diamond with sapphires all around it. And I thought, no, that's an engagement ring. I can't buy myself that ring. So then Sebastian called shortly after, found out what I was doing that day and that I went into a jewelry store and where I was. Once we hung up, he called that store and he said, there was a tall brunette that just went in there to try on a diamond and sapphire ring. I want to give you my credit card. I'll be in either next week or the next, and I'd like to buy the ring. So he bought my engagement ring before we started dating. Wow. And so when he pulled that out to propose, it was the ring that I had tried on. And it was just like, it informed me exactly who this man is. And we've now been together 14 years, married 12 and a half years, and he's still that guy.
Speaking of that ring, can I tell the story about her?
If you want.
Yeah. So that ring. So we got engaged several months later in Paris, and it was unfancy, but she notices everything. She just like picks up on anything. So I had to hide this ring in a pouch inside of a pouch inside of a pouch inside of a pouch
inside of a fanny pack
inside my pants for what? Well, I know that sounds kind of weird. You know, one of those like travel packs.
Right.
Don't give me that face.
Well, the pack was inside the pants, not outside.
It was like thin.
Yeah, but
travel
it was still
packs,
inside the pants.
That was like inside. And then I was like, I got our passports. I got our money, honey. Everything's safe here. Anyway, let's move on from that detail. I had this plan that turned out to be, there's Makaka. I had this plan that sort of went out the window because we had this magical, special kind of spiritual day early on in the trip. And I just knew this was the day. And so we were walking around, it was late at night, and my heart started beating like crazy. She could sense something, but didn't sense that. We got to the hotel door. She said, you want to keep walking? I said, yes, please. Can we do that? Let's keep walking. And we found some steps by the Seine right there. It was just beautiful. We were holding each other. And suddenly we hear this gorgeous cello sort of wafting over us. And at the top of this, at the bridge there nearby, there was this beautiful music coming from this musician who was a street musician.
Go, babes, go.
All right. Anyway, I know it's the moment. I start dipping into this pouch and taking out one bag and throwing it and taking out another bag and throwing it. And I finally get to the ring. I propose. And it was a special moment. And then, of course, the most special. And then at the end of it, we walked up after a bit and spoke to this musician and we said, sir, bonjour. Forgive me. We just got engaged to your music.
You essentially underscored his proposal, and you know
it was a. This is a moment of the moment of our lives. Please, just for our own posterity, can you please, please tell me your name? And he says, Brad.
And we were like, what? We're even French? Like, no, just as American and as flat as it could be. Brad,
we'll
he
take
didn't
it.
Care. Anyway, it was underscored so beautifully.
So Brad, the American cellist. Thank you.
Downer.
Hey, this is a comment I thought you guys should see. Look, I'm only home when I'm off too. Hospital RN upstate here. So very glad when I can catch these. Thank you, Patricia. Thank you for being on the front lines for all of us. Just like,
thank you, Patricia. Truly.
Thank you for your service.
Okay, so before our next little segment, which you're going to enjoy, Stephanie, we want you to sing a song from Falsetto Land, which
okay,
which yep. really sums up what the hell we're dealing with.
Yep.
I'm going to step away for you.
Yep. But you have to do this because I don't know how to do that. I'm not good at any of that. Ready? Yep. Are you guys ready?
We're ready.
Here it goes. I was sure growing up I would live the life my mother assumed I'd live. Very Jewish, very middle class, and very straight. Where healthy men stayed healthy men, and marriages were long and great. I smile, I don't complain. I'm trying to keep sane as the rules keep changing. Families aren't what they were. Thank God there's a husband and a child whom I adore. But then there's more. So many more. There's always a man. Life is never what you plan. Life is moments you can't understand. And that is life. I'm plain. I don't astound. I'm holding to the ground as the ground keeps shifting, keeping my balance square. Trying not to care about this man who Marvin loves. But that's my life. He shared my life. Yes, that's my life. Life is never what you life is moments you can't understand, and that is life. Holding to the ground as the ground keeps shifting, trying to keep sane as the rules keep changing, keeping up my head as my heart goes out of sight. Everything will be all right. Everything will be all right.
Ah, so great.
Oh, man. I'm the luckiest to have been able to sing that.
Right.
That song, play that role. Yeah.
Look at that. Already crying. This has been my anthem.
Wow. Yep. We so all need those anthems. We're hearing lyrics differently during this time as well. Like the whole day just kind of takes on a different meaning. So I'm with you, Sophie.
Oh, man. Oh, we have some nice news. Don't forget, people are donating. You go to Stars in the House.
Right.
And I kept saying, even the dollar helps. It doesn't help because the minimum bid is
$5. $5.
So even $5. But it really does help. And through all these bids, we've raised so much money. So these are just a couple that have come in.
So these are some more.
I know. For drama.
I know, Seth. There's a name on here. You'll see why that's number one.
Yeah. And
I already knew dramatically to do it last, but this one has to tell me to make sure I do it last.
No, I'm a drama queen.
And you hate that term.
I do hate that term. It's so stupid.
Janet from Missouri, $25. Thank you so much. Mary from New Jersey. Okay, Mary from New Jersey, $25. Janet from Missouri, they sound alike, $25. William from California, $100. Gasper from New York, $25.
Gasper,
I love that name. Kelsey from Massachusetts, thank you for $25. Danielle from New York, $50. Catherine from New York, $50. And the one that he was just talking about, listen to this. Alisara from Thailand, $50. And,
wow,
and Actress Fund just texted me because they text me through, you know, throughout the show. Fun fact, this is Maggie from Actress Fund. Alisara from Thailand messaged us, meaning the Actress Fund, to say that she's been watching every single episode since Kelly's first show. This is now her 20th show that she's watching.
Wow.
From
that's amazing. Oh, wow. Amazing.
Thank you so much.
We love Thailand. James and I went with Julie. We love Thailand.
We've never been, but we do want to. We really do want to do that quick.
That food there and those massage. I mean, you can't. And it's so beautiful.
Yeah, people are so nice.
Okay, so listen. Dr. John LaPook always says, we've got to keep in touch with our friends throughout all this. And you'll appreciate this. The second night we were distancing, we got a FaceTime call from Liz Callaway. And just seeing Liz on the phone, I was like, oh my God, like I was so happy to just see a friend. It's really important. He says, think of three people you can call or FaceTime. So we saved you the trouble and we FaceTimed your pal. Here she is, Ms. Kay Alicetto.
Oh! How are you?
I'm trying not to cry. How are you?
So good. Are you? What are you doing? Are you by yourself?
I am, but I have a puppy that I got over a year ago that is basically saving my life, especially in these times. So, but I'm okay. I'm okay, and I'm actually in the process, weirdly enough, of moving. So, which is interesting in and of itself. But that's okay. But yeah, I'm good. And I'm so happy you guys are on the show.
We're so happy to see your face.
When was the last time you were at the house? I'm going to tell you. The last time I was at your house, you invited me, because I'm going to cry. You invited me for dinner because my mother was about to pass away. And I wasn't home for the last Thanksgiving. And so you said, come over with us. And this was, I think you were still pregnant. Yeah, with Viv, and you had told me part of the story of how you and Seb met, and I was like, are you kidding me? You must be joking. She goes, no, and I'm going to show you a clip of us singing together on Wicked, As Long As You're Mine, and I went,
I did that. Oh, yes, man.
Turns out, true story.
Thank you for being my friend.
Come on, man. The first time I met you, Stephanie, was when I did Hands on a Hard Body and you had just finished Root.
Yeah.
And so unfortunately, we were all given the opportunity, because we were nominated for Tony's that season, to go to all the parties and everything and all the luncheons where everything was like a deconstructed champagne or a deconstructed salad, whatever it was.
Right.
And so everybody else would have to, you know, kind of go off and say, well, we've got a show, and me, you, Tom Sturridge.
Right.
And,
we would go out to eat.
We would all sit there and go, well, we got nothing to do, so let's go to the bar. That was the first time that you told me about Covenant House.
And you said yes. You didn't even blink when I asked you to sleep that on the
Describe screen. What it is. Describe what Covenant House is.
Covenant House is a safe haven, a place where anybody from the age of 16 to 21 can go. They can go as a one-off for a safe place to rest their head.
Get food for the night.
But if you want to make the covenant of continuing on, of getting your general education, of trying to get all of the paperwork that you need to fulfill your dreams in the world outside when you get a little older. So that means anything from getting your driver's license to finding your social security to finishing your GED. They've got doctors on call for physical health, mental health. It is like an all-encompassing place of love where they not only accept, they honor these kids, they love these kids, they lift them up, and they send them out into the world where they have wonderful, productive lives. And they are needing us now more now
than
ever, because kids are coming and looking for a place to stay. They're so scared that they could be ill. And Covenant House and our president, Kevin Ryan, is just this massively open-hearted.
He was just on TV.
So once a year, we do a sleep out under the stars to honor them. We're not pretending to be homeless in any way, but we're just saying, we see you, and we're going to be uncomfortable for one night while we fundraise and raise money. We're also collecting. I have have a fundraiser page. So I know you're giving to the Actors Fund as well. But if you have a little extra that you can give, Covenant House is needing you desperately right now.
Oh. Again, $5, if you have $5, is great.
Covenanthouse.org. And last night, just in their location in New York City alone, they housed 300 kids. Worldwide, they housed 3,000 kids last night. And that's 3 meals a day. Trust us, every cent you give will be used towards these kids, and we are grateful. Thank you so much.
And you know, let me say one thing, which is interesting, because you know, we're asking for money for the Actors Fund, but another way you can help Covenant House, and I know we have to be careful with sanitizing, but if you have like little shampoos, anything you can drop off, come in with no products. And if you just have things in your house you got from hotels, you do like, what do I do with all these soaps? Covenant House loves that kind of stuff.
You know, the thing at Covenant House in New York, they have this thing called Covingdale's, which is their version of Bloomingdale's. And so anybody that wants to bring in, again, if they can clear sanitation rules, if they can bring in any kind of clothing that they've never worn before, or I know Andre is a big fan of that, or, you know, just toys for kids, because they also take in
mothers with kids,
mothers with children, or who were pregnant mothers who haven't had their kids yet. And so they'll take anything like that. And if they can use it to sustain another life, they'll absolutely do that.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
Oh, we love you. By the way, this is Kay Alicetto, the bearded lady from The Greatest Showman and the star of Hands in a Hard Body. Ran for 4 performances. Brava!
Brava! And the last time you saw her on this program, she was wearing her dress from the what? The Oscars!
Come on! From Kristin Shoriano, who I might add has just made over 1,000 masks.
Masks,
For all the healthcare workers and PPE for the city of New York.
Yeah.
Incredible.
So, Kiel, I'm going to bring you back in a second. Stephanie, do you want to reveal what, you know, you're going to add to the auction?
Yes, and Kiela, stay right there, because, again, we are connected by Hugh Jackman for the opening night for Boy from Oz.
Oh, hold on. I wanted to say, Stephanie J. Block starred opposite Hugh Jackman, Boy from Oz. He played Peter Allen. She played Blasia. Okay,
oh my
good.
God. I was Cher. I was like, oh my God, it was terrific playing Liza. No, that doesn't work. Anyway, so at the end of The Boy from Oz, we would all do a number with maracas. So for opening night, he got us these glorious boxes with these gold maracas. It will say to Stephanie, so you're going to have to, you know.
Great.
From Hugh, it says The Boy from Oz here with the opening night date here. Only those in the original cast have them. I'm going to be putting this up for auction.
Oh my God.
There's also another cool gift. I'm re-gifting a gift that was given to me 25 years ago.
Good.
So 25 years ago, I did my first regional production of Funny Girl. Ted Sperling was our director, and he was in Funny Girl with Barbara Streisand.
Wait, what? No.
Yes.
Sperling was in Funny Girl with Barbara Streisand. Ted Sperling is way too young.
Here's the mug that Barbara gave them in 1966.
Boom!
Yes.
I'm sure he got it somehow. I'm going to text him right now. Hold on.
Text him.
Text him, you're wrong, and now everybody knows on live television.
Now I really love Liza, because Liza likes to create her own memories in her own way. She's
that is not 70 years old.
For 25 years, I have believed that this has come from Barbara Streisand.
Everyone, please donate to the Actors Fund. We're doing this all for you.
You better call Ted right now. Look.
He's calling.
I'm calling.
It literally says his name, Ted Sperling. It says Funny Girl. It says 1966. Oh. It's engraved.
Ted is not 90 years old. There's what he was in that
Cal is loving this.
Oh, please be wrong. Please.
Hold on. And while we're doing that, I'm going to play you a clip of Seven Eyes singing As Long As You're Mine.
We would love that. Hey, Stephanie, why don't you give us a song while I make this call?
What am I doing? Oh, okay. This is good. All right. I have trouble hearing this moment, right, let's try. It's a very sweet song called You, and it's by Great Big World. Great Big World. Go, Bebs. Here it goes. I hope you can hear this. It starts out with guitar. This goes out to you, Ted. If you can hear me, tell the right story. way beyond the stars was a dream there waiting for a dreamer to dream her. Barely just a spark in the open darkness of the ether, the world beneath her. I never could imagine how my life would change the day you came, and how all my fears and worries would just wash away. I never saw it coming, then one day, all of a sudden, there was you, 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 you. I don't have to live without you anymore. How could it be so that a heart this full could burst wide open, be reawoken? Little did I know what a simple thought could set in motion a drop in the ocean. I've never seen the flowers or a sky so blue. It's all brand new, like a sign in the horizon coming into view. I spend my whole life running, then one day, all of a sudden, there was you, 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 you. There was you. Have to live without you anymore. Oh gosh, I hope you can hear it. It's a cello. It's so beautiful. I've never seen the flowers or a sky so blue. I never saw it coming. Then one day, all of a sudden, there was you. There was you, 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 and I don't have to live without you anymore. No, I don't have to live without you anymore. Oh gosh, I hope you could hear that accompaniment.
Yeah, it's so beautiful, babe.
Little tunes.
So beautiful. And yeah, you can totally hear the strings.
It's beautiful. You can? Oh, good. Okay, what's
up? Well, you're coming back, hopefully.
Comment, hold on. Currently watching from Ireland with my daughter. This is everything that everyone needs right now. Such an amazing couple. Isn't that nice?
Thanks.
Okay, so Stephanie, I'm bringing on my other guest for a moment. So I'm saying peace out to you for just a second.
Take a little break. Stand by.
So it's Thursday night. So we thought it's such, must-see television on NBC. Stars a certain wonderful actor, and he's living in the most beautiful living room. I can see him on the screen right now underneath us. Please welcome to the stage, not really a stage, Mr. Eric McCormack.
Hey, Eric.
Hi, you guys. This has been some show.
Where are you? It's so beautiful.
I am in my home, which happens to be decorated by the guy that decorated Will and Grace for 20 years, Peter Gursky. So if it looks nice, I can't take any credit.
Art imitates life. So Eric, we keep saying you've got to reach out to your friends. We know you're social distancing, but even in real life, your annoying across the hall neighbor is right next to you, and here he is right now, Sean Hayes.
Here to annoy you via
you
the
are possible. I love you. I spoke to Sean just today.
I know. I'm going to be surprised. It's not that big.
Not really. Hey,
but
Sean.
But you didn't tell him, did you?
No, by the way, let me be honest with you, as I always am, Seth, I didn't remember this was happening today. So I spoke to Eric out of the blue because we love each other, not because of this. And then you were like, you're going to be on tonight? And I was like, yeah, totally.
Shani, tell us where you are right now.
I am at the DMV. I'm at home in the kitchen with Scotty, who's just out of reach.
Hi, Scotty.
If you don't mind, hi, Scotty. I love seeing people's houses. Sean, will you just show everybody your amazing jar of M&Ms, which I constantly eat whenever I'm there?
Sure.
It's the most, Eric, you've had those M&Ms, haven't you? The same ones that have been there for 10 years, but aren't they great?
holy crap. No, because I make it in the show and I sit down and I never get to the M&Ms.
Oh, I just love them. So, guys, what can you tell us? First of all, the episode's going to be on in 15 minutes if I brought you on.
That's the crazy part. I don't think we're on tonight.
All my planning was for no reason?
No. No, but, Sean, let's talk about next week, because next week.
Yes.
Is 2 weeks. 2 weeks.
2 weeks?
I think so.
Okay. Well, anyway, the next episode, whether it's next week or the following one, is the I Love Lucy episode. Yes. Oh.
Please describe that because people are going to freak out. Go.
Okay. So the basic premise is, so for 20 years, we've known that the setup that we have is basically I Love Lucy, Grace and I, and then the neighbors come in. And so they were trying to figure out a way to do this and decided all three of them, Grace, Karen, and Jack, think that they are Lucy to my Ricky. So we reenact, and I haven't seen the finished product, but the shooting of it was so easy for me because I'm just Ricky. And everybody else got to do some unbelievable makeup work. So look forward to that one. That's
Yeah, but when we all came out at first in full makeup and costume, whether, you know, whatever character we were playing. And there is Eric dressed as Desi Arnaz, and he opens his mouth, and I had never heard him do it before. And I started laughing so hard because it's so spot on. He becomes Desi Arnaz. It's crazy.
And we got 3 days into rehearsal and everyone's like, oh, you do such a, and I suddenly went, wait a minute, is this okay that I'm being like Spanish on television? Are we allowed to do this anymore? But
Hence, it's the final season. Sean, do you play Lucy and who else? You actually play Lucy like in drag?
Everybody played every part except for Eric was the only one who had a consistent character of Desi.
So you get to be Ethel?
I get to play Ethel and Fred and Lucy, yeah. It was really fun.
Oh my God.
I'm particularly sexy as Ethel. Particularly sexy. Yeah.
Because the thing on everybody's mind, it's blowing up the internet, is the I Love Lucy shows.
By the way, it actually is, because we're all sitting, you better shut up. We're all sitting home and we're watching comedy. Of course we're going back to the old favorite.
No, I love it. We actually still watch them. We're obsessed with them. I think they're obviously hilarious. Yeah, it was actually amazing. And Lucy Arnaz, Derek, did you just say this? Because I kind of checked out. Lucy Arnaz is.
No, he didn't say it. Tell everybody.
Lucy Arnaz was on the show with us.
Right.
And
Lucy comes in.
Go ahead.
No, so just to have her there. And there was just this moment. I was in the hallway where the dressing rooms are and the makeup room. And I meet Lucy Arnaz for the first time. And at that moment, Messing walks out in full Lucy mode. And it was amazing to see Lucy Arnaz see her mother made flesh. It was unbelievable.
Amazing.
What is this? Sean?
Little Sean.
Very similar. Hold on, this one knows, hold on.
We're playing our song. What's wrong with you two? Of course, of course.
Hey, oh, the playing our song.
Hi, you guys.
Oh my gosh, hi, you guys. Obsessed Sean, with everybody on here.
That you're Joe Exotic is a
rock. I was so moved by the story of you proposing. Because incredibly, right now I'm wearing a fanny pack in my pants. I mean, that happening.
Stephanie,
I'm trying to check
it
safe.
Out. It's the way to keep things safe.
Stephanie, I'm going to read this to you. Sean was texting me And he literally wrote, I'm obsessed with her. She's effing amazing, obsessed. I can't believe that just comes out of her mouth. Like, my cereal comes out of mine if I eat too fast. Well, you know that part. But
what comes out of her mouth?
I'm obsessed. You guys? You guys.
I mean, I like, we saw you as, you know, in your Tony winning a performance last year, or was it 2 years? It was last year.
Last year, yeah.
And, oh my God, you're unbelievable. It was unbelievable. It was mind blowing.
Yes, I gotta say this. So Sean had invested in a Broadway musical. I think, what did you invest in? SpongeBob SquarePants or something?
SpongeBob. Hang on 1 second. That's probably the mailman dropping off the residuals. Yeah, no,
it's a windfall. But I was so inspired that when the Cher show came up, I invested. So I was actually
Eric.
I invested in the show. I was a little tiny little producer on the show.
Well, now you're going to go on tour, right? So it's
hitting all these towns across the country. My Sonny Bonham. My wife is saying, what is that? What's that? Oh. My wife is saying move closer to the camera.
Oh.
So, which is...
is it to hide the fanny pack with all the amounts of money from being a producer from the Cher show?
Okay, hold on. Every single one of you from all has done a Broadway show. I want you each to give me.
You were incredible in that. Absolutely incredible in that.
Thank you, guys.
And Kel and I did Graham Norton show. Do you remember?
I do. I was petrified. I was so scared.
You sang your big song from Greatest Showman, and Deborah and I were there. It was just so.
I totally remember that, and I was so scared because I was there with Graham Norton. I was there promoting a show, and I was there with Erin McCormack and Deborah Messing. I didn't know what to say, and I looked like I didn't know what to say.
Seth, you've lost control of this completely.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to take people off screen because you're all annoying me. So what? You've each done a Broadway show. I want you each to tell one story about doing a Broadway show. So hold on. So I'm removing. So Eric, give me a story about when you did Music Man. Hit it.
Oh, okay. So Music Man, the thing that actually Stephanie was referring to before, she was talking about a put-in rehearsal. So I took over Music Man from Craig Bierko. I had 2 weeks rehearsal with no one, with just one actor, my friend Cynthia, and the musical director, and that was it, or assistant musical director. And the day I went into the show, my put-in was on a Tuesday afternoon, and I went on that night and had never virtually met any of the cast, and then did 100 performances. So it was
trial by fire.
Yeah, my hat's off to that cast. Like 19 years later, because they were amazing and so sweet, and
so are you.
And might I add, so were you. Eric was amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Hazel
completely commanded the whole stage the entire time.
Sean, I'd like to talk about your amazing, and I mean, brilliant performance in Promises.
That's
incredible.
Everybody's wanting it to come back.
Well,
I don't think that's not what I meant. Talk about your amazing performance. And by the way, I just want to say this for the actors out there. I saw Sean, it was one of the most brilliant performances I've ever seen. And yet, you were nervous a lot. So talk about I love that someone could be amazing and still be insecure. Talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of an old story, but I had horrible stage fright, like the first maybe month of the run or something, where I would go to sing and nothing would come out. And I was like, guys, I quit. I can't do the show. I'm not doing that every night. And all the producers were like, well, you have to. It was just ticket sales or blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yeah, but I go out on stage and nothing comes out of my throat. So it'd be like, what's that song? How was the first song?
Half as big as
life. So the last note would be big as life. And I'd be like, forever. And I would go, half as big as life. With the orchestra still playing. And then I would just go,
yeah,
for life. And it was awful. It was a horrible experience. And then I overcame it, and it was fantastic.
God, you were good at that.
Yeah.
What you got?
Me?
Yeah.
The first time I ever went on for Hairspray, the first job I did, I was a standby on the first national tour of Hairspray. And the girl that I was standing by for, her name is Carly Gibson. She's incredible.
She's great.
She's actually doing a live dance show as we speak, like on Instagram Live, I think, or YouTube Live. Anyway, she had an ocular migraine, and there's a part in the show in the beginning where she couldn't go on, I think. I may be mixing stories up, but whatever, it sounds good. So anyway, there's a part of the show where they do this big dance called the Grand Madison, and she sneaks out the back way behind the rest of the ensemble, and everybody's going, Kelly, she can't do it anymore. You have to go on. We're going to pause the show. And at the time, the person that was playing my mother was Bruce Blanche. And so they paused the show. And I was like, oh my God, this is really happening. This is really happening. I'm putting the wig on and everything. And he goes out and says, ladies and gentlemen, we paused the show because my daughter, my first daughter cannot do it right now, but my backup daughter is about to come out. She's a Polynesian princess. She looks nothing like the first daughter, but we're going to make it happen. And I'm like, wow, just the best setup ever. So they start the music back up. And there's, when she comes back out into the audience, she goes, and I am Tracy, supposed to be the same person. And it ended up being me going, hi, I'm at least a foot taller and don't look anything like Carly, but I'm Tracy. And everybody just kind of started laughing and clapping at the same time. In my head, I'm going, just keep going, just keep going, just keep dancing, yeah, for God's sake. I was petrified. I'm always scared. So I don't know how any of you guys get over it. It scares me half to death.
Yeah. Kerry Butler always talks about your pal, Kerry Butler, Eric McCormack. She was playing Belle, and my friend Andréa Burns was her understudy. And Kerry was doing the show, same thing, got sick in the middle. And Kerry's really tiny and petite with a little voice. And Andrea's like a woman. So Andrea said it was basically like, Kerry was like, oh, right, papa. And then a second later, Andrea's like, bonjour, papa. And I was like, so, like, you're a
it's
monster.
Scary.
It's not scary. All right, Stephanie and Seb, you got anything for me from Broadway?
I have, you know me, if you're in my life, shenanigans just always happen. You don't know this story. So let's go back. I was playing Liza. I'm waiting in the wings to go on. And our stage door guy was, anyway, he was a really nice guy, but sometimes people would just get in through the stage door. So I was actually served papers. I was summoned as on stage in costume as Liza. They were like, you've been served. And me with like my big eyelashes like this going, what the hell just happened?
Best theater story ever.
Best.
Wow.
It was a manager who had been with me during the creation of Wicked out in Los Angeles, who then wanted a piece of the pie because I had moved on to do The Boy from Oz, but then had been offered to move forward with Wicked after The Boy from Oz. Wow. And so he wanted his piece. So he served me papers. And in walked this man in the wings at the Imperial Theater going, are you Stephanie Block? Yes. You've been served.
And you're like, I'm Stephanie Block. Are you an asshole? Yeah.
Yes, girl, we need to talk.
We did have a conversation, and I had to come to write a little checkeroozy.
No way! That's such a crazy story.
Had to
before the curtain call?
No.
Wow!
Believe it or not, during the show, this was in Act Two. I was in the purple chiffon, about to go on to meet Hugh. It was like a quite a scene in the wings, stage right at the Imperial Theater.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
So, Shawnee,
that's the stuff that happens to this girl.
Shawnee, you're going to come back for the whole show, but we still got to see the auction item. So, Seth, for yours. Kayala, you have something that you're going to auction.
I, too, have something, if I can get it out of here. It's from Justin, Paul, and Bench Passick. It was a gift that was drawn by Justin Squiggs Robinson. And only the people in the picture got it.
This is from The Greatest Showman?
Yeah. Oh, and we got it on basically like our last week of initial photography before we wrapped.
Beautiful.
And it's gorgeous, but I would love to auction it off if we can make some money for the actors.
Yay!
And if I can, I'll get it signed by Huey. Because obviously this is going to happen for a while. And once we all get back, we can then send them out. So hopefully I can get it signed by him.
Can I jump in and just say, I wanted to say at the top, Keila, I saw you in Hands on a Hard Body. I thought you were fantastic.
Oh, one person. Thank you.
Oh my gosh. That laugh. That was infectious. It was incredible.
That scared the living daylights out of me too.
Tony nomination, girl. Okay, so wait, we got to close this. Shawnee going to come back for a full show. Maybe we'll have like a whole Will and Grace because we're starting to do TV reunions here. We can't reveal what shows. Maybe we'll bring everybody on.
We've got three next week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night. And I think between the three shows, maybe like, I don't know, 36 Emmy Awards, something like that.
Just saying.
But we can't say. It'll be who's counting?
So, Sean and Eric, you're all going to come back. We got to close with a song. How about your beautiful, beautiful duet, Sebastian and Stephanie?
Come on, please.
Yes. Oh, sure. We've never sung this. So we will be looking at lyrics.
Okay.
I'm going to bring you guys on randomly while they're singing. So if I bring you on, you're looking at your phone, you're going to be outed. So I'm on full focus right now.
Or else, bye-bye.
Okay. Full focus.
Okay.
Ready?
Sean!
Sean!
We already turned off.
And if you're going to eat M&Ms, you better grab them now. Go. Can you hear it?
Yeah, it's good.
How they play, finding treasure in the sand, they're forever hand in hand, our children.
How they laugh, she has never laughed like this.
Every waking moment bliss. Our children, see them running down the beach.
Children run so fast
toward the future
from the past.
How they dance, unembarrassed and alone, hearing music of their own. Our children,
one so fair
and the other lithe and dark, solemn joy and sudden spark. Our children, see them running down the beach. Children run so fast toward the future from the past. There they stand. Oh! Making footprints in the sand, and forever hand in hand, our children, two small lights, silhouetted by the blue, one like me and one like you. Our children. Our children.
So sweet.
Oh, we couldn't hear the key change.
Make out.
Yes. You got to pay money. You got to pay money for that. All right?
Guys, I can't believe. I just said to Scotty, I can't believe we get to see that for free. Like, that's unbelievable.
Oh, come on.
It's amazing. Wow.
Thank you. We have final donations.
Well, some people donated tonight, which we appreciate. Whatever you can give. D. Scott from Texas, thank you. $100 to the Actors Fund.
Thank you.
Kelsey from New York, $30. Paul from New Jersey, $25. Debbie from California donated $100 tonight. Woo-hoo! And Rena from New York, $25. Gary from Ohio, $25. Samantha from Massachusetts, $100. And from Kentucky, Catherine donated $255.
Yes!
I don't do math, so what is that, like $90,000 we raised tonight?
Sure. So they keep coming in after the show, so we'll announce our total tomorrow. Okay, everyone's going to, by the way, everyone's coming back. So, Kayla, this is your second appearance. Eric and Sean, 7 September. Anything you have to say?
No, this is our first, this is actually our first night, our 20th show that we don't have the doctor in the house.
He texted, Dr. John LaPook had to actually be a doctor tonight. He was like, I've got to do the Hippocratic Oath. So the book's not here. He's back tomorrow. Tomorrow afternoon is an In the Heights reunion with the stars of In the Heights.
Yes.
It's one of my favorites. Miranda sings.
Colleen Ballinger, yeah.
That's right. So you guys, thank you for everything. We'll all see you soon.
Love you guys so much.
Thank you guys.
You got to show the dog.
Thank you, everyone.
Here is he.
Why I had to get up.
Yes,
sir. He was whining and barking. Be safe. We'll see you.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye, Kayla.
I love you guys.